Hello, everyone, and good afternoon. Welcome to the webcast. My name is Christine Dursey, and I'm the Executive Director of APA Ohio and Vice Chair of the New Urbanism Division. I will be the moderator for today's webcast. Today, Friday, August 16th, we will be hearing the presentation, Beyond Low Impact Development, Density and Form-Based Zoning Codes for Watershed Health. For technical help during today's webcast, type your questions in the chat box found in the webinar toolbar to the right of your screen or call the 1-800 number shown. And also for content questions related to the presentation, type those in the question box also located to the right of your screen. Right now, please take a moment to see the list of sponsoring chapters and divisions. I would like to thank all those participating sponsors for making these webcasts possible. Today's webcast is sponsored by the Connecticut Chapter. For more information on this chapter and how to become a member, please visit the link www.ccapa.org. And to learn more about all the chapters, visit planning.org/chapters. And on your screen is a list of upcoming webcasts. To register for these webcasts, please visit www.utah-apa.org/webcasts. And as always, like us on Facebook, Planning Webcast Series, to receive up-to-date information on the Planning Webcast Series sponsored by these chapters and divisions. To log your CM credits, go to planning.org/CM. Select today's date, August 16th, and today's webcast. And this webcast is available for 1.5 CM credits. Okay. I'm going to introduce our speakers now. There we go. Hiram Peck is our first speaker. As a professional AICP certified planner for over 25 years, Hiram has worked with municipalities, the federal government, USDA, regional planning agencies, and private clients. His focus has always been on the land and man's optimal relation to it. As Director of Planning in Simsbury, Hiram has worked extensively on consensus building processes. Recently, these involved a community design charrette and adoption of a form-based code for Simsbury Town Center. He has been working with several firms and groups in many states on form-based codes for over 6 years. Other recent efforts include drafting a planned area development regulation, which was recently adopted in Simsbury. Two PADs have already produced a restored grist mill restaurant, 88 apartments, 20 townhouses, an MS housing project, and an urgent care facility in Simsbury. Work on low-impact development, stormwater policies and regulations, and workforce housing development zones were also recently adopted. Other current endeavors include significant mixed-use development, specialty housing, and transit-related projects. Before coming to Simsbury 7 years ago, Hiram was the town planner in New Canaan, Connecticut, for 7 years. During this time, the POCD and zoning regulations were completely revised, and many major projects, including construction of Teen Center and the preservation of an important historic downtown theater and other town-owned historic buildings, were accomplished. Hiram was also the senior planner and then assistant town planner in Greenwich, Connecticut, for 7 years, and did coastal application reviews and assisted with the update of the POCD. Previously, he had worked with the 8 towns in the Southwestern Regional Planning Agency region in Fairfield County when he worked for SWRPA on many environmental projects. He has also worked for COGCNV in Waterbury, Connecticut, on environmental and transit programs. Before his service as a U.S. Army officer, Hiram attended Cornell University and the University of Connecticut. He has taught science at the secondary level and geology at the college level. He is also a consulting planner and a Connecticut licensed arborist. He has also served on the Board of Selectmen and Board of Tax Review in his hometown. He is also a CNU member for the past few years. In his spare time, he enjoys showing his Parson Russell Terriers and bicycling, although not at the same time. Our second speaker is Jonathan Ford. Dedicated to smart growth and new urbanism led Jonathan Ford to found Morris Beacon Design, a new urbanist civil engineering consulting firm, in 2006. Jonathan's experience is diverse. In addition to 15 years as a consulting civil engineer, he is co-founder and past president of the New England chapter of the Congress for New Urbanism, a Knight Fellow in Community Building at the University of Miami School of Architecture, and on the faculty of the Form-Based Codes Institute. Jonathan has been published and has lectured across the country on a range of topics, including walkable neighborhood design, density for watershed health, and smart growth infrastructure planning. He is a licensed professional engineer in Massachusetts, Rhode Island, North Carolina, and several other states. John and his family live in walkable Providence, Rhode Island. Okay, I'm going to turn the presentation over now to Hiram. All right, Hiram, are you there? Uh-oh, hello, Hiram?
Your participation.
Oh, please there provide... we go.
Okay, start again?
Yes, please. Could you please speak up, too? Thank you.
Sure. Greetings. Thank you for attending this session this afternoon. I appreciate your participation. My presentation will present some background information and some context for the Beyond LID work done by John Ford at Morris Beacon Design. The work here in Simsbury has been quite successful to date, and we started on this, and I go through a little bit through the process of how we got that, got to that point. But as many of you probably know, blending higher density development, especially in a small village in New England, while assisting in cleaning up stormwater at the same time, is often difficult to do. Sometimes these ideas seem like they should fit together very easily, and they are often quite difficult to do. A lot of the literature talks about what the density, that is the impervious area, should be in the watershed, and sometimes you run into figures like 10%, and people talk about trying to make sure that the imperviousness is not exceeded. One of the things that we are really striving to do here is to look specifically at the situation we have here in Simsbury to try to indicate that we can, in fact, integrate green infrastructure into the planning process. We started this process in about 2009. We're still working on it today, but I'll talk a little bit about how we got from the very beginning when I first came to Simsbury into where we are at this point in time. Just a little bit about the background and the context in Simsbury. In 2007, about a year after I got here, we finished Plan of Conservation and Development, which in Connecticut is required to be done by municipalities every 10 years. One of the other documents that has been very helpful with regard to the planning process here in Simsbury are the Guidelines for Community Design. These guidelines are used by the Design Review Board in their review of all the non-residential projects that come into town, and recently was updated after extensive review specifically for the town center. As you'll hear more later on from John, the Simsbury Stormwater Design Guidelines, the articles that were presented and put together as part of that process, and several of the test areas that were looked at are also key in developing downtown and other areas looking at LID at the same time. And finally, we have the Simsbury Center Code that was developed in 2009 and 2010 and adopted in April of 2011. These documents essentially serve as a basic backdrop for the work that we'll talk about today. A little bit about Simsbury. Simsbury is a small New England valley town typified by basalt ridges running north and south in the town. Talcott Mountain Ridge runs on the eastern side of town. There is a significant change in topography from the west, where it's quite low, to the east side of town, where it's floodplain. The east side of town drains to the north flowing Farmington River. It's characterized by meanders and an extensive floodplain in the town center. We're also lucky in a way that the river actually meanders around the center of town, provides a significant amount of open space that I'll show you on some of the graphics that I have later on here. But it does provide a large natural area in the center of town. This is a photograph of the town center, pretty much as it is now, showing that the high slopes on the west, the ridges drain toward the east and toward the Farmington River. The road that you see running through the middle of the town, essentially through the middle of the study area that we did for this charrette, is Route 10, so state highway, two-lane state highway. Residents have been very specific that they would like to see it remain a two-lane state highway with as little modification as possible. But this gives you a basic idea that the drainage from west to east is an important factor in looking at how we approached LID in Simsbury. Just to give you an example of some of the structures that are in town and some of the sensitivities that we had to deal with during this process, just like to show you that on the upper left is a Starbucks that was an old house that was going to be torn down for retail activities. The Design Review Board was instrumental in making sure that that was not torn down, and in fact does still serve to this day as a really nice Starbucks, very busy place directly across from the town hall. The lower left is a small shopping center, also in the same area. And what I would like to bring people's attention to is the arrow in the center of the rear of that photograph. It shows the ridge, again, on the eastern side of town that shows a significant delay in the topography, the relief in the topography. And the photograph on the far right just indicates what the town hall looks like. Again, another historic structure. So we had to make sure that anything that we came up with would match with these types of structures here in town. Again, just a couple more structures that are in the center. Upper left-hand corner is a real estate office. The upper right-hand corner is a funeral home, actually. Years ago was a home. It converted to a funeral home and has been there for many, many years as well. The town's sensitivity to a green infrastructure is sort of portrayed by this small park, the small Vestpocket Park. It's called Schultz Park in the center of town. Significant number of very nice specimen trees, pervious walkways, and significant landscaping right directly in the center of town. One of the churches that's in town, again, indicates that it's well landscaped. Note that the sycamore tree there is part of our streetscape plan. They've been around, obviously, for many years, and that has continued to be, they've been replenished, reestablished whenever they've broken or somehow been destroyed by storms. There's no new development plan for this particular site, but it just provides good context for that particular area. Another town center historic home, past influences, again, that the town is concerned about, indicated by the fact that this was originally the homestead of the Eno family, famous for U.S. transportation activities, was the birthplace of Gifford Pinchot, first director of the U.S. Forest Service, and the homestead firm out of Hartford did the original landscaping on this property. Landscaping has significantly changed over time, and it's not nearly as nice as it once was, but the structure is still there, and obviously a historic structure. Town has an easement on the front lawn of this property to make sure that nothing inappropriate happens on this property. Another town center building, and this one's of particular interest to us because it was originally a home in the 1900s, obviously a fairly large home. Then it became a bank and an art gallery. It was recently sold when the bank decided to relocate to smaller headquarters, but the future use of this building is particularly important because it is in the town center and because it is in the area that's governed by the form-based code. You can see that the typical street lamps that are located there are town standard street lamps, and this particular building will be very important going forward in our discussion. The planning issues that the town was faced with during the period that I've been here from 2006 until when we actually did the Town Center Charrette in 2009 were the fact that, as you've seen, I have a number of historic structures I have to deal with, but the actual development in the town center was really quite slow. There was nothing else going on. There was no activity. The retailers were complaining that there really wasn't a lot of activity in town. We wanted to see what we could do to spur on economic development. there was a difficult land use process. There were many boards and commissions that people had to go through. The fact that in Connecticut, in this particular town anyway, the Planning Commission is separate from the Zoning Commission, is separate from the Conservation Commission, which is also separate from the Design Review Board, and there are a number of other boards and commissions that projects have to go through. This may not be different from lots of places in New England, but it certainly is different from lots of places in the country. The difficulty of the review process was certainly putting a crimp on development. Not that all residents necessarily objected to that, but when I came here initially, I was understood that creating economic development in an appropriate context with the right texture was important to do. Just before I got here, I was faced with a large format retailer that had proposed a development in the south end of town. And that particular development, in addition to the big box, had a number of other uses associated with it. But the total development in that area was about 900,000 square feet. What this development did was, and it's probably not atypical for many towns, is it really sort of fractured the town. There were many people that thought that that development was far too large and should never be built here. There were many other people that thought that the economic development was a good idea. So the idea was is to try to heal those fractures in the town development process, at least the perception of it, and to make sure that people felt comfortable going forward about how development was done in the town and to make sure it was done in a transparent fashion. Now the town is focused on a design and the historical and keeping historical buildings and making sure that they're appropriately used. So that in 2009, we did a full-blown town center charrette. There was a lot of discussion about what that activity should produce, and basically it was decided that what it would produce would be a form-based code. The Design Review Board thought that that was an interesting and appropriate way to proceed. The townspeople were uncertain about it, but it was clear that what we needed to do in order to make sure that if we were going to produce significant density in the town center, that we had to do that through public consensus. That is just critical to the process that we use, and it was very important, this particular process. The Design Review Board is a non-regulatory board in that it makes recommendations to all the other boards and commissions, but it reviews all non-residential plans. The development process ultimately was streamlined by the form-based code in the town center, and the Zoning Commission adopted a consent agenda process in 2011. That also has sped up the process whereby things can be approved that are actually of a smaller nature, and actually up to about 25,000 square feet can be approved administratively. That's actually very unusual for that to happen in Connecticut. Why do we want to do a charrette? Why do we want to do a charrette? This photograph, many of you have probably seen that before, but it's fairly typical of what the land use process looked like, although the costumes may have changed somewhat. And perhaps the actual firearms aren't used anymore. The actual difficulty in getting through the land use process in town was certainly something that many of the economic development people were very concerned about. So what we did was we made sure that we started the process in a very public way. We did lots of advertising, lots of public TV, lots of posters, certainly on the website, lots of public announcements. And then in 2009, opened up the building in the background here is the Simsbury Library to the public. As you can see, the hours for the charrette were 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. Those were actually fairly modest. We probably were there before that and probably there after that. But for that whole period of time, there was a significant amount of work going on to produce this particular code for the town center. We had a full house. We didn't really know what to expect, but as you can see from some of these photos, the room was packed. There were probably in total over 600 people that attended these charrette sessions. For a relatively small town like Simsbury, which is a population of about 23,000, that was a tremendously gratifying to see as many people interested in the development turnout as possible. We tried to involve as many segments of the community as possible, including the Boy Scouts. We tried to make sure that there were a number of opportunities for young people to participate in this process, and made sure, for example, that they could, in fact, participate in the process on their own and not be sort of drowned out by lots of the older residents. We can see that there are a number of people that attended. For selectmen is sitting there in the front row, was very interested in what was happening as well. And the attendance was not only good, but was extremely productive as well. The town itself has two main roads. That is a state road I mentioned before, Hop Meadow Street, which goes through the center of town, right there, if you can see that. There's another road that was constructed about 20 years ago, 20 to 24 years ago actually, called Iron Horse Boulevard. And that was constructed as a bypass road to relieve the traffic on the state road in the town center. There's a fairly narrow town center, actually, with a relatively small number of cross streets right now. But one thing that's really significant about it, as I mentioned to you before, is that in addition to the fact that it's significant, all the stormwater drains from the hills to the west across town center to a large floodplain on the east. This area was wisely purchased by the town a number of years ago. It's about 400 acres and was known originally as the Baker property. It's now known as Simsbury Meadows. There are a number of things that are taking place in that area, in addition to a number of trails that are through that area and a wide variety of environmental activities through the area. There's also some development that's on the edge of that area that we'll take a closer look at later on as well. So that was the outline of the study area that we used for the charrette. In all reality, all we did really for the charrette was look at the town center area between these two streets. And the floodplain area and the open space area was not a direct part of the coding that involved a lot of time. There were no structures proposed out there, nor did anybody think that there should be. That is the area that there is currently a construction yard on that site. It seems like it would be not a wise thing to do in an area where there's a floodplain. That particular area, there you sort of see that there's a pad there that's elevated above the floodplain, and you can get the idea that it is not directly in the floodplain, although you can see from some historic meanders that took place in that area that it goes very close to the construction yard that's there today. We'll get some more closer pictures of that in just a second. How do we fund this is usually a question that people ask, and we had very small amounts of existing funding, but there was some existing funding in 2009. Part of that funding was directly from the town. We also had a grant that was from the state with regard to incentive housing zone, that is producing affordable housing in town. Each of these grants had specific requirements. I'll go through those in just a second. We also had a grant from the Connecticut Trust for Historic Preservation. Culture, parks, and tourism was a very big part of what the town was interested in, and very interested in making sure that the town remains an active tourism destination. The town was recently named one of the 12 distinctive destinations, and the first one in New England to do that, to gain that, and we're very, very proud of that as well. Connecticut DEP, or now DEEP as it's called, produced also a small grant for us to make sure that what we did was in keeping with the water quality goals of the Farmington River that flows north through the center of town. What we ended up producing out of the incentive housing zone grant was a workforce housing opportunity zone with zoning regulation along with design guidelines, some historic preservation, and we redid the charrette, work on the design guidelines that I mentioned a moment ago. And as far as the discussion today is, the Connecticut DEP provided the funding for the LID work and actually the beyond LID work that John Ford did for us in the town center. What we hope to end up with is a set of documents that came out of the charrette that are complete and comprehensive, and all those documents are found in the regulating plan of the town center code. The question then becomes, once we got all this new density planned for, if we have significant new density, how are we going to deal with the stormwater and not upset the new code? They're very difficult spaces to find to put stormwater, and many of the urban and even more densely developed suburban situations have difficult times finding places for that stormwater to go. How do we fit all the pieces together? We were convinced that we needed to use LID. We needed to use light imprint as far as that applied as well. And one of the things that I was particularly interested in was disconnecting the sources of where the stormwater originated from the receiving water, that is the Farmington River. Treating at the source whenever possible was important for us to consider. and developing alternatives wherever they were needed was also critical for us. This just simply runs down some of the things that we did with regard to how we got the money to do the charrette and how we got it to do the form-based code. Important in this list is included in the LID work as part of the charrette process. People were told from the beginning how this would work and how it would fit into the whole process. We also worked with the University of New Hampshire Stormwater Center, and we actually conducted a workshop here in town for the town engineers in the area. Many of the town engineers in the smaller New England towns are very set in their ways, and that's not necessarily a bad thing, but the thing is that they're not necessarily very comfortable with lots of the things that LID talks about. And so instead of using just LID, they'll also require some existing techniques to be used, basins and pipes, when they're not absolutely necessary. We wanted them to understand what we were trying to do here and hopefully gain an appreciation for the LID tactics and principles that we were employing here. One example of what we did with the form-based code, and you may like this or may not like this, but the idea here is that there's some existing structures in town that were not necessarily structures that were going to be kept forever or that had a particularly redeeming historic value. This is an existing office and some commercial space that's on Hop Meadow Street. Now you may recall that I showed you that Hop Meadow Street and Iron Horse Boulevard run parallel to each other, run both north and south. This particular structure is an office and a commercial space, as I said, and one of the ideas that somebody came in with very quickly after the charrette was to develop this particular piece of property. I'll show you a little bit about what happened here. If you look from the Iron Horse Boulevard side uphill to this property, you can see that there's almost a story difference in elevation. This is viewing from Iron Horse Boulevard upslope to Hop Meadow Street. Take that same house, and you can see that that same house added to the right side of this particular structure was a relatively small part of what could be proposed as far as a new development was concerned. This was just a conceptual sketch that was brought to the commission after the code was adopted. The commission decided that if in fact it did come back as an application, it was something that they could possibly favorably consider, although no formal decision was made on it at that time. Because of the financing and the personalities involved, this particular project has not gone forward yet, but it's still in the wings, and hopefully it'll go forward sometime in the near future. On the lower side, I mentioned that this was a through lot. On the lower side, on the Iron Horse side of this particular parcel, there's another structure. And this, again, was a brand new structure where there's nothing that exists right now. And you may be able to see that on the lower level, there's parking underneath this building, and you still have 3.5 stories of structure above it. So it's a significant structure where there's nothing right now, but I'll show you in a moment as we get to the code, the details in the code, about how that all fits together. This is a picture of the illustrative master plan that came out of the charrette itself. This is the area, the contracting yard that I mentioned we focus on in a few minutes. This is where the town hall is located, and the structures I just talked about are in this right area right here, where Hop Meadow Street and the through lots down to Iron Horse Boulevard. This is the Town Center form-based code. It's a street-based code, and there are really only 5 zones associated with it, SC 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Obviously, as you can see, it's a street-based code, and so those of you that are familiar with that realize that the street and the street frontages actually dictate many of the uses that are found in the code. The only area that's SC 5 in this particular code is, again, this area here, where the contractor's yard is located. A significant amount of additional development is potentially able to be located there for a couple of reasons. One is the fact that it is substantially lower than the rest of the town center, so there's a significant amount of additional height that's possible there, as well as the fact that it looks out over that significant floodplain that I mentioned before. It's not in the floodplain, but it looks out over it. The regulating plan is established, and while these may not be easily readable, it simply sets out the particular designations, SC1, SC2, 3, 4, and 5 for the particular zones. There are also some civic sites which are set aside, the Performing Arts Center and the open space that's part of the floodplain in that area as well. interpreting the regulating plan. This is another important part of the code. Again, a street-based code. You see in this particular diagram here in the upper left that these dash streets are their existing pathways or pass-throughs, but they're not actually technically municipal streets at this time. So they're more alleys than they are anything else. So they're indicated by dashed lines as opposed to the solid lines. This street here, which is Wilcox Street, the center of this diagram, is a central retail street and the primary focus for creating additional retail on that street, along with the historic structures that are shown here in black. Those are the structures that are called keepers or structures to be preserved. So that retail street actually focuses on, is anchored by some of the historic structures on the front of Wilcox. One of the things that we did in the town center code was to make sure that the height restrictions were observed. There's the old town hall, which is called Eno Hall in the town center, has a wonderful cupola on top of it, and it's a historic structure. It was built in about the 30s, 1933, I believe. And what we wanted to make sure was that no other buildings in that area were taller than that structure. So there's a respect paid to the height of that structure, and this height map was prepared in an effort to make sure that no structures within that yellow boundary there and through here are any higher than Eno Hall. Even the structures that are on the downslope are required to be not higher than the roof, the main roof on Eno Hall. So that was an important part of the getting the people to understand how height would be impacted on this particular structure as well. In the SC1 zone, typical, this is along Hawk Meadow Street, basically, bring the structures to the street. Lot sizes are relatively small, pitches on the roofs are dictated, transparency of the windows, a typical form-based code documentation. In the SC3 zone, just skipping over the SC2 for the moment, on Station Street, this is a typical, again, type of development, a fairly crude boxing diagram, but still, basically, the idea is bringing the structures to the street. Some additional height, some additional density. Roof pitches are still controlled, as is transparency and the facade articulation, but that is typical in the SC3 zone in town. On the site that we'll talk about a little bit more later on, the Simscroft site, that is the construction yard site, you can see that there's a significant amount of additional development that's potential there. There's some significant density that's there. There's an additional height that's there. It's actually the only area in town where there are four stories can be allowed in the town center, and I think up to 56 feet. So that provides a significant height advantage for that particular site. A summary of the frontage requirements is also found in the code for all the various frontages. The lots, again, are fairly small, 5,000 square feet. One thing that's important to note here is that there is open space involved on all the lots in town. Typically, it's 15% for most of them. It gets higher in the civic and the open space zones, but basically there is open space involved so that there's room to put some of the stormwater, plan for some of the stormwater accommodations on each of the sites that we're talking about. This area that we'd like to focus on now is the Simscroft site that I pointed out a moment ago, and I'd just like to say that that particular area will get more attention by John in just a moment. This is an aerial photograph of that area. You can see that the obviously it's an active construction yard. We've been very fortunate in that the person that operates that yard has constructed, even though it's close to the river, a very clean operation, make sure that nothing flows into the water bodies or the wetlands that are near that. You can see also to the left of the construction yard is a large open area, and that's the Performing Arts Center. This is what the plan envisions for that area, a significant amount of residential development, a road that goes around it, also places for people to park to either look at the open space or hike down through the open space, but also significant residential development for the town center. Plans for this particular project are in fact underway, and there are three people that are looking at that now with competitive designs. We think that the green infrastructure is a key component to this process. We would like to continue to build public acceptance by using consultants who actually get it, who understand what our basic philosophies and policies are in town, to integrate those solutions into the new form-based code, as has been done with our LID work, and to integrate those policies into the plans and the regulatory framework in town. We selected Morris Beacon Design to do that work, and I'm sure you'll hear more from John about how he did that in just a few moments. Just another quick example of some of the development that could take place in the town center. This is an existing intersection of Iron Horse Boulevard and Wilcox Street. This is what it looks out on Iron Horse Boulevard. We're very serious about biking here in town. We're one of the first biking-friendly communities in the state. We have sheroes on many of the roads and a multi-purpose trail that's even to the right of that road so that the type A bikers that want to fly through town can do that, while the moms and the baby carriages and the people, the elderly folks that want to just walk and stroll at a leisurely pace can also do that as well. Same intersection with some development for the future, what that might look like. Same intersection with a little bit more development in the future as well, just keeping in mind that this whole thing looks out over about 400 acres of open space. Very design. Actually, it's very interesting that during the charrette, someone came up to one of us and asked, could they put a deposit on this apartment up in this corner already? Very, very glad to hear that type of recent reaction. This is the type of area that it would look out on. Again, this is the floodplain area that the town uses as a recreation area, and about, as I said, about 400 acres of open space. Performing Arts Center, band shell, any given Saturday night during the summer, there may be anywhere from 5,000 to 7,000 people there listening to a concert. Simsbury portion of the East Coast Greenway is also what they look out on. Again, this is just another view of the Performing Arts Center or the Simsbury Meadows plan. We're very serious about sustainability here in Simsbury, and we try to keep that in mind with everything we do. This sort of very typical diagram of what sustainability is like, obviously has social, environmental, and economic components to it. And many people have talked about this concept in many of the meetings that we come to. It's actually a lot different than some of the typical zoning meetings that you might run into. But in fact, what people do is they do talk about it, they do think about it. And so what they decided to do a while ago was to actually memorialize some of the sustainability into a concept that we have at the Performing Arts Center, where we take a broad look at the world, the social, environmental, and economic impacts of all our planning activities. And this statue was recently put in place to commemorate that type of outlook. Thank you very much, and I'm sure that John will have lots more to add in terms of details about our LID work, but thank you very much, and I'm happy to answer any questions later on. Thank you.
As the presentation loads, I'm Jonathan Ford. Thanks very much, Hiram, and thanks to you all for joining us on this Friday afternoon, Friday summer afternoon. It's beautiful here in Providence, Rhode Island, so especially to those of you in New England joining us this afternoon. Thanks for joining us for a few hours. Before jumping into the Simsbury-specific work we did in the Simsbury Stormwater Module, what I'd like to do is run through a quick, less than 5-minute history of stormwater management. And this slide will hopefully advance. There we go. Okay, the 5-minute history of stormwater management is an introduction to the Simsbury stormwater module. Conventional stormwater management, what we've seen until the last 10 or so years, where stormwater runoff is fed via a system of catch basin and pipe to the magical retention basin on the outskirts of civilization, where stormwater runoff is dealt with magically, never to be seen or heard from again. And what we see here and what we've been calling this is the pipe and pit methodology, what I call heat rate mitigation banished to the backyard, where it's not doing a whole lot for neighborhood health, social connections, economic value, and
I'm sorry, John.
Vitality, but also not.
I'm sorry, I would like to interrupt. We're getting some notes from people that you're fading in and out. Could you try to speak closer? I don't know if you're on the phone or if you're on speaker. If you're on speaker, do you mind taking it off?
I'm not on speaker. Let me try to speak differently. Hopefully that's better. Please keep me updated. I'll get the microphone closer
sure.
to my mouth.
Right, great. That would be great. Thank you.
Please keep me updated.
Will do.
Thank you. So conventional stormwater management in the recent past, and relatively recent past, evolving and technical difficulties here, to low-impact development, or LID, and I'm guessing most on this call are familiar to some extent with LID, but very quickly, LID principles to reduce impervious cover, to work around existing natural systems, native vegetation, natural areas, and hydrologic patterns, to utilize less complex non-structural best management practices, or BMPs, like rain gardens, disconnection of downspouts, permeable pavement, green roofs, bioswale, as a way to naturally filter and infiltrate stormwater as close to where it falls as possible, and to create a multifunctional landscape where stormwater function can also double for aesthetic neighborhood improvement. And we're seeing that adopted more and more across the country. And you can see that, and I'll show a few New England examples, but across the country where state stormwater design handbooks, guidelines, and regulations are using LID as the core tenet of the stormwater management and site design approach. So we see this Massachusetts stormwater handbook on the first page, LID. We see this on the first page of Rhode Island Stormwater Design Manual, which is brand new as of December 2010, where LID is the new way to handle stormwater. The problem that we're facing is that the LID technology and the LID toolkit, which is a huge advancement in stormwater management technology, is still being applied to the same old land use patterns on the whole. So we see here single-family residential with every single LID BMP you could think of applied from Vermont's LID webpage. We have here rooftop disconnection, we have a rain barrel, we have rain garden, a swale, a permeable driveway, preservation of the existing tree, which is looking beautiful in the back, and even a green roof. Here from Connecticut Stormwater Quality Manual, a similar application or integration of the residential rain garden, but in large lot residential. Example of what it looks like in practice. Here from New Hampshire Stormwater Manual, the overlay of LID technology in the form of each of those red arrows representing the disconnection of downspout or impervious area, but overlaid on the same old land use pattern of disconnected cul-de-sac, dendritic tree pattern, and a lack of the public realm that I think a lot of you are looking for, especially within your existing town centers or proposed new town centers for a vibrant public realm. Not just applied to residential, also retail, if we're talking about separation of land uses, shown here in the 2004 Connecticut Stormwater Quality Manual, where the mall can accommodate swales, overflow permeable parking in the form of turf pavers, even a transit stop and a bike rack. And one of my favorite illustrations is showing the success of LID from Rhode Island's 2010 manual being going from two cul-de-sacs to one. As an example of conservation subdivision. And I don't mean to be overly critical of LID because it is a huge leap forward for stormwater management. But when we're talking about form-based codes, when we're talking about density and being fitting within urban context and character, LID really needs to be evolved because right now, on the whole, it's a new one-size-fits-all albeit an evolved one-size-fits-all application for the same old land use act. But I showed my neighborhood in Providence, Rhode Island. This is Coolidge Corner in Brookline, Portsmouth, New Hampshire. The types of vibrant, connected, dense places, the complete streets, active streets, high value, well loved, well visited, on-street parking, buildings to the street. We're not seeing integration of stormwater management yet, except for a few isolated examples here and there. And God forbid, we talk about watershed health in Manhattan in the same sentence. But really, this is an extreme example, yet. But we need to be talking about how density, when looking at a town, a neighborhood, a watershed, density is the ultimate stormwater BMP. Having more development intensity and energy with less impervious area. So really looking not at a site-by-site approach, but at an overall approach, a watershed approach, a per capita approach. Okay, getting to Simsbury and how we did that in Simsbury, the types of places in how to land to this in great detail. What is envisioned in Simsbury, both to preserve the existing historic character and to add growth in the right place as expressed by the consensus vision. The density is pretty significant, and what we're seeing here is buildings close to the street, parking in the back, a pretty high level of imperviousness, but also a pretty high level of density in complete streets. So what we needed to do was tailor the stormwater approach, and we did the stormwater work for the whole town, but to focus on the town center and understand how density works for the division in the form-based code and how the various zones within the form-based code might respond differently to the stormwater management and site design. So very quickly, I've written extensively about this online. You can go to my blog, or there's an article on climate design. LID 2.0 is what I'm calling it, moving past LID. And I shouldn't say moving past LID, but using the foundation of LID, building on it, so to speak, to incorporate the connection to land use patterns and growth over time, and also to incorporate a greater flexibility to design context. So I'm not going to talk about all these pieces, especially given the time, but the focus in Simsbury was really on number one here and number four. Not all impervious area is equal, or in other words, integration with land use patterns and density. And number four, designing to context, or how to integrate LID specifically at the block, street, building, and neighborhood scales to Simsbury Center. The work itself, the stormwater module, was in three pieces. The stormwater article, which would be the ordinance, the concise regulatory language to be plugged into zoning. The site planning and design criteria checklist, which I'll go through in detail, but that's a requirement for projects, for applicants to fill out that checklist part of the stormwater article. And the stormwater design guidelines, which were an expanded document to show the how and the why of these more innovative guidelines and regulations using a few test sites, specifically within Simsbury Center. All the work really was in support of the 2007 Plan of Conservation and Development, but looking at it through a few slightly different lenses, protecting natural resources, preserving and enhancing community character, utilizing some typical LID principles, and then thinking a little bit differently, using a watershed and neighborhood approach to say compact development can be a strategy to reduce impervious area in the watershed, to establish these watershed-sensitive planning design criteria at the neighborhood, block, street, and site scales of development, not just the site-by-site approach. And to define standards for incorporation of LID DMPs that are appropriate for land use context and site conditions. So starting with the performance standards or the ordinance, the regulatory work, I'm going to go into detail on the planning and site design criteria checklist first, talk a little bit about stormwater quality and quantity requirements, the specific performance standards and how they differed for zones within the town center, and then talk about design and construction requirements. The intent of the planning and design criteria checklist was to incorporate and infuse LID and context-sensitive LID into the planning and design of all projects. So this is required for all projects, and I'll show the ways that applicants can respond to these criteria at different scales. But some of the highlights were requiring an enhanced existing condition plan to fingerprint the existing conditions to a greater level of detail, to plan around and with natural conditions. Limitation on ornamental lawn. We included green street design guidelines, which were very important as Hiram went through some of the conditions within the town center where there are some informal ways that serve kind of as alleys now that are foreseen in the future as streets. So there's a potential for some very serious retrofit opportunity there. Permeable parking requirements for lots in excess of 10 spaces. And a discussion about special detention areas where flood control can happen in the right place. And I'll talk about that. And also design the right way so that the potential for multi-function open spaces such as plazas, parking lots, fields, et cetera, within compact and walkable zones. And I'll talk about the Simsbury Center Watershed Planning and Design Framework. So I'll show you a few examples of the checklist. And if you look to the right of the page, the responses are either verified, technically infeasible, or not applicable. So we want these considerations and these criteria to be incorporated into the thinking. This is what the town is looking for. But we understand and we want to be sure to plan some flexibility into the process, because we understand a lot of these, in doing the regulations and doing design guidelines for the town as a whole, can't necessarily, not every project can have every single criteria applicable within their borders. DC is broken into watershed, neighborhood, green street. For example, you see near the bottom, one example of criteria is thoroughfare and driveway pavement width are the minimum required to accommodate public safety and emergency access. So we can achieve traffic calming there within the town center while also minimizing the impervious area, which can be a significant impact. But it may be that is not applicable for a project. Moving on to more detailed site design criteria, for example, 4.2 infiltration DMPs are located in areas of well-drained soil. That may be technically infeasible due to ledge, or maybe the soils aren't well-draining, but we want this checklist to be filled out and submitted so the town has a starting point. The parking design requirements, DMP design requirements, and maintenance requirements. And I say requirements, what I really mean is criteria, and that there is some flexibility. Part of the criteria includes for projects within a town center an analysis of how a project fits within the Simsbury Center Watershed Planning and Design Framework. And what we did here was apply environmental conditions and constraints as an overlay to the Simsbury Center regulating plan to show how urban conditions, urban intensity, and different development patterns in the nuts and bolts of the zoning fit with soil conditions, topography, especially, and flood zones. And not surprisingly, as many New England towns are, that the town center is really already in the perfect spot in a lot of ways. It's just outside the flood zone, and Simsbury mentioned the flood plain, Simsbury Meadows. It's just east and down gradient. and most of the poorly draining soils are just outside the where significant growth is envisioned. So what we wanted to show was for different urban intensity, how stormwater would be handled. And since we had well-draining soils pretty much throughout the town center on the whole, we can encourage infiltration to the maximum extent possible. We also show, and you see those asterisks, what might be potential stormwater receiving zones. So Hiram's slide showing those puzzle pieces not fitting together, this is exactly where it comes in, with a form-based code showing additional density over time, not necessarily being able to accommodate advanced requirements for stormwater flood control, especially. We always want to try to see water quality requirements met as close to on-site as possible. But if there's additional flood control to happen, instead of having a detention basin or a costly underground detention on an urban site or an urban infill site with significant constraints, can we work to locate those on the edge of the neighborhood where they can be efficiently built in the right place and hopefully with the right design for a shared neighborhood solution? And that's the benefit of using the form-based code integrated with stormwater, is to get those shared solutions in the right place, combining the environmental constraints and conditions with the future vision for what this place will be. So we included some discussion about how different zones might handle stormwater differently based on their urban intensity and context. All high infiltration capability, so we're really encouraging infiltration on site where possible. One thing to point out is a good example of an application of a one-size-fits-all LID methodology to a place like Timsbury Center. It may be that a mixed-use retail street, over-greening is a concern that can be possible. Maybe not necessarily in Timsbury, but in some places where I've worked that don't want to have a 10-foot-wide fire retention cell between on-street parking and their retail visibility at the very pedestrian scale. So maybe that some zones need to scale back a bit or find ways for those shared solutions to work as a win-win. I'm going to move through these a little bit. We've talked a little bit about open space and potential stormwater receiving zones, locating these in the right place, and using some precedent to show how different types of open space, active, passive open space, could also accommodate stormwater management, from a pocket park to a larger neighborhood park, to playing fields, and other types of open space. We really want to encourage the right neighborhood solution in the right place. Okay, stormwater quality and quantity requirements. We had requirements in the zoning language for redevelopment for sites that have over 50% existing impervious area. To have alternative requirements to encourage redevelopment and reuse of existing infrastructure. And what I really want to highlight, especially in the interest of time, is to move into one of the keys of the work, which was alternative performance standard requirements for heat rate, recharge volume, and water quality within designated, compact, walkable places within town. So for us, we are focusing on the town center here. And you see underlying the off-site mitigation and stormwater mitigation bank, which I want to mention, was very much encouraged by the town as a way, if you look at the town center and the watershed plan, if stormwater and shared solutions are going to happen, the town has set up a mechanism to both encourage and we hope facilitate some of that shared solutions, whether it's paying into off-site mitigation to happen in the right place for the plan or providing these shared solutions. But getting back to alternative requirements for rate, volume, and water quality in walkable places, this really is where we got to the intersection between form-based code and density for watershed health. Work we did a few years ago for the EPA comparative infrastructure analysis of smart growth on the top versus various methods of building out that same growth using more conventional separated and sprawling land use patterns. We looked at a number of various alternatives. The EPA at the time wanted to prove to the large home builders that it cost less, it was in their best interest to build smart growth, that the infrastructure cost less. And we looked at really a can of worms in terms of the number of variables involved, but in looking at side-by-side scenarios, we were able to come to some conclusions as they relate to infrastructure costs. And what Morris Eagan Design has done since to build on that relationship between pervious area and infrastructure costs, and I should mention upfront infrastructure costs as well as maintenance of infrastructure over time, were significantly reduced for the TND, traditional neighborhood development scenarios, compared to the TSD or more conventional suburban development scenarios. But to build on that and look at watershed health, so the more pavement, the more rooftops we have, the more infrastructure, the more land we're eating up, obviously would cost more to build, but also result in more impervious area for a given increment for development. So for example, if you look at total phosphorus, the bottom left graph, and those are three comparisons of different apples-to-apples development build-out scenarios, the TND on the left, TSD on the right. But the TND scenarios, by virtue purely of land use patterns and density, outperform the conventional scenarios by far, even more so than what you typically see from some of the latest and greatest LID best management practices. So here we're showing that TND land use patterns outperforming LID BMP technology. That's the first step, density as the ultimate stormwater management watershed health BMP. And then we're integrating the latest and greatest BMP technology and solutions on top of that. So in Simsbury, this is a graph showing as density increases, the annual runoff volume decreases on a per capita or per residential unit basis. So we looked at the construction yard site, you see at the bottom in yellow, and we said, well, okay, here's the filled out for the Simsbury Center code. What would that same build out look like in terms of impervious area and watershed impact if it were built out per the zoning on the book? And you can see that graphically, the impact is significant. And if we look at impervious area, look at runoff volume, the Simsbury Center approach are outperforming conventional mid to larger lot zoning. And what's important about this, I think this would be intuitive knowing what we know about development footprint and conservation, planning practices, et cetera, but can we parlay this into the zoning code to help incentivize and enable growth in the right place? So if we say that we can provide incentives for zones located within the town center in peak rate, recharge volume, still outperform the zoning that's on the book. You see at the bottom, Simsbury Center with incentives, cutting recharge volume requirements, still outperforming the typical zoning. So the two key words here, to me, you think about it differently through different lenses. Are we incentivizing? Are we enabling? Both really work because the vision has been set in the form-based code for Simsbury Center that's adopted. So we want to be sure that we can use this as one way of enabling that density, enabling those conditions in the nuts and bolts of frontages, parking in the right place, and density. This, along with stormwater banking and off-site mitigation, gets some redundancy to help get growth in the right place, reuse of existing infrastructure, and really a watershed-based approach to the form-based zoning code. We had site BMP incentive credits for projects within designated compact walkable areas, Simsbury Center primary among them. And I'm, in the interest of time, going to move along a little bit to get to the design guidelines. When it comes to planning, stormwater management, and site design context, this is the context envisioned. In the code, we wanted to make sure that our BMPs the LIDs, the DMCs, are appropriate for that context. So we looked at different types of water quality DMCs, from a rural swale to a residential street, maybe some mixed use or more urban conditions that become harder edged, more defined, and linear, and tree box filter you see in the bottom right. We can look at that approach, the contact-based approach to DMCs, looking at permeable pavement, for example, from rural to emergency access applications to more urban permeable concrete, pavers, or bituminous. Even looking at permeable on-street parking within different conditions, from grass, maybe compacted stone, pavers, stone dust, and then come up with a table, and a lot of you will probably recognize this approach from the light imprint, the urbanism approach, where BMPs are calibrated for context. You see the town center zones listed across the top, other zones on the right. The dark shading is where BMPs are encouraged within those zones. The light shading is where they're allowed, and the white areas are not allowed without town engineer approval. The stormwater design guidelines were a separate companion document to the stormwater article and checklist, where we went into some detail and used specific test sites to establish why Tim Gray was thinking this way and how to meet specific design criteria using these test sites within Simsbury Center itself. So you recognize the Simstrop Farm site again, the construction yard located to the east of the town center. We envisioned an illustrative plan within the guidelines of the regulating plan. So within the area itself, we redesigned the Town Center Code's illustrative plan work product to use the principles that we had put forth in the article and in the design criteria, showing how specifically on this site we'd work around existing natural conditions, if there wasn't a lot on this site, but there is some, and how you see on the left of the design, those are stormwater receiving zones for upland Simsbury Center zones, where that could be the stormwater receiving zones, and that's in the right place, where pocket parks and green streets can work to enhance the public realm while also providing potentially some shared solutions for block development, and how BMPs are calibrated to the specific context. And you see in the bottom right, defining and design criteria, how we might see that playing out for this specific design. And there's some commentary within the design guidelines themselves for each criteria for this specific test site. And we have these drawings by Russell Preston, who's an incredibly talented developer, architect, and illustrator, using the exact blocks from what we were looking at to show topography, to show how the BMP design and layout and site design would work using Simsbury appropriate architecture as well. So for example, this block, which is moving towards us, one of the common design challenges I face in translating an illustrative plan to a more specific, taking it to the next level and getting it designed and built. The frontage on a sloping site becomes a bit challenging when the setbacks are reduced or zero and you're still requiring 100% water quality or flood control on site. When you don't have that setback at the frontage and you're having a fairly dense street wall condition where the side yard setbacks are reduced as well, you have a pretty consistent street frontage here, that stormwater runoff coming off the building to the front or down gradient, it becomes challenging to find a place to deal with that. And that's a very detailed site design consideration, but one that becomes a challenge when integrating micro urbanism and form-based codes with more advanced stormwater requirements. We wanted to provide flexibility so you could have flow-through planters within very limited frontage conditions. This is a perfect example where and a cut in the performance standard requirements to help enable this block to be built as envisioned. And there's also the potential for the off-site mitigation to happen. So we also pulled, and a lot of what we've been hearing, and what I've been hearing in all areas where I'm working, is that we might not be seeing a neighborhood built in the next 5 years. We might not be seeing a block built in the next 5 years. But what we are seeing, and we want to be sure to accommodate, is smaller scale incremental growth on the level even of the site, and what that would look like within a plan like community centers, where if you have, say, a 40 by 80 block that looks like this, it can still accommodate stormwater infiltration and water quality on site without having to have a detention basin somewhere. So we have flow-through planters in the front yard. We have flow-through planter in the back, which may or may not have liners that overflow to a rain garden that would accommodate rooftop runoff as well as from the outbuilding, and then overflow to a rear alley to show that we can get stormwater function on the plot, not just without compromising the urban condition, but by also enhancing it, we hope. And we looked at a lot of the symbols of how those requirements work in conjunction with the incentive. So I think in the interest of time, there are two more test sites. This one was a much more mixed use retail block with parking to the interior. It showed, I think one of the things we want to show here and one of the common impediments to LIB in a town center environment is often state setback to infiltration requirements, where if you're required to set back 25 or 50 feet from a building foundation for an infiltration BMP, that might work fine on a big box retail, but that really eliminates a lot of possibilities on a block like this. So if we're going to do permeable parking spaces, for example, having them in the right place would be maybe 10 feet away from a building foundation, and also designed with the topography to prevent run-on from standard two-minute pavement onto the permeable pavement, which sometimes causes clogging, especially when not maintained. These are some of the conditions that we wanted to explore and understand how it could and should work. And we did the same thing for another site that was much more redevelopment and infill, smaller scale block, more topography. And the last thing I want to show is an evolution of what I showed earlier, the conservation subdivision LID plan going from two cul-de-sacs to one. We can think about an evolution of LID, both in terms of how it functions environmentally, how it functions from a quality of place standpoint, and how it can knit into an existing neighborhood where we're increasingly seeing in New England and I think across the country, cottage court as an alternative where you can get density, you can get buildings fronting on common spaces that can also serve for stormwater management. This is a project we built in East Greenwich, Rhode Island called Cottages on Green, 15 two-bedroom cottages on 3/4 acre. With LID's best management practices, including swales and bioretention woven through the site, permeable parking to enhance the quality of place as an alternative for the LID 2.0 conservation subdivision, if you will. So with that, I'll hand it back to Christine. Again, thanks for your time and look forward to questions.
Great. Thank you, Hiram, and thank you, John. We do have a few questions, and again, if anyone else has any questions, we have about 15 minutes left. You can go ahead and enter those into the question chat box to the right of your screen. This first question is for Hiram. Hiram, you showed a regulating plan with dashed lines for throughways that are not full public streets. In this case, do those dashed lines represent public right-of-ways? If not, if they are private property, how is development regulated along them? Must development front them, or could future development cross the dashed lines?
Interesting question. Great question. One of the dashed lines actually goes right through some private property. During the charrette process, we thought that property owner might well be very interested, to say the least, in the fact that we had put an alleyway through the property. In fact, the plan was so well received that there was no pushback, negative pushback from it. So that was one on private property. A couple of the others are on public property, although they're really not well-maintained full municipal roadways at this time. So it's a combination of private property and public property. We think that they're all realistic. I think there was only one in the whole plan that received any pushback, and that ran through the church property, and the church decided that they were not ready, in fact, to do that. And so we eliminated that from the final plan. But other than that, it worked out very well. So I'm not sure if that completely answers the question or not, but I'm happy to address it more fully. If you want to email me, please feel free to do that.
Great. Thank you. Sure. The next question is for John. What was the amount of Simsbury's contract with Morris Beacon?
The amount of, that's an interesting question. I think you saw the grant that was the town secured from the state in the name of LID. So I don't think I want to throw the number out there. It was not extensive, but it did allow us to do the stormwater article and also the design guidelines. We felt it was very important to have both, and we were able to fit both within to that account to ensure that the zoning language was as concise as possible, but it wasn't out there in a vacuum, that it was clear and backed up with the design guidelines. So I think it's a question of scope and fee, and I would very much encourage, and ideally having this work integrated with form-based code design preparation in the first place, but to ensure that work is integrated so the final end product encourages growth and it's clear and it's consistent.
Great, thank you. And stay on the line because this next question is for you too. Are you recommending the residential roof runoff from gutters and downspouts should not be connected to the storm sewer system? If so, will this increase basement flooding? Our city's property maintenance code requires gutters and downspouts to tie into the storm sewer system.
That's a great question, and that's one we're dealing with here in my neighborhood in Providence. I think it's a pen answer. We certainly do, in theory, want to encourage disconnection of rooftop runoff and pavement impervious area so it can filter, so we can slow down the runoff rates and get it into the ground as close to where it falls as possible. That's the starting point from an environmental perspective. It depends if we're working in areas where we're talking about retrofit, where whether you have basements or not, what are the conditions of waterproofing, if it's new development, are there basements or not, and what are the setbacks from those foundations. So that all really can be put together into a better picture of what can happen with this connection of downspouts. Here in our neighborhood, we're working hard to push forward some retrofit because we're dealing with some very, very significant, both from environmental impact and financial implications, consequences of the end of pipe. So if we can get those disconnection of downspouts through the neighborhood to the staff, and need to talk about retrofit, rain gardens, and that type of thing. But a study was done in the next neighborhood over that did look at that and showed that there needed to be some caution in that neighborhood because of 100-year-old homes, as well as density, where maybe it isn't a perfect solution there. So as always, it depends on context. And I do think a lot of state regulations, guidelines, and municipal guidelines can tend to be overly conservative and one-size-fits-all. So I know that's not a specific answer, but we do want to encourage that infiltration slowing down or not up where it makes the most sense.
Thank you. Hiram, is the Simsbury Stormwater Design Guidelines available online?
Yes, they are. Actually, on our website, town website, which is shown on the contact information page that John's put up, they are there. And if you have trouble getting to them, just email me, and I will make sure that I get them to you if you'd like that.
Okay. This next question is for either one of you. How has the development community responded to the additional costs associated with the higher density and BMP requirements of low-impact development? What about the general public that typically hear high density and automatically assume more traffic and congestion?
I can talk a little bit about the Simsbury reaction. One of the things I mentioned in the beginning of my presentation was that it was our desire to build a strong public consensus for this program from the outset. And that came from the fact that, as I mentioned earlier too, that there was a 900,000 square foot development that did receive no public input before it became an application, and it was a bloody summer, frankly. That's not the way to do it. The way the community responded to our approach, our transparent approach in creating the code and creating the density, was phenomenal. I can tell you that, as I said, over 600 people attended the charrette. The final presentation for that program was about an hour and a half, well, it was actually about an hour and 45 minutes. Nobody left the room. I can also tell you that the Zoning Commission unanimously adopted the form-based code. There were almost no comments in opposition to it, and it's experienced very, very good reception. When I explain it to developers, at least in Connecticut, about how the development process works here now, they're just stunned at how significantly improved it is over the former process. We think that we can save them money and time, and obviously that's very important in their bottom line too. So we're very impressed with how it's worked out so far. John may have had other experiences as well, but that's been our experience here locally.
Well, yes, I'm speaking specifically to LID. One of the things I always try to do with my project, whether they be zoning or neighborhood planning or getting construction documents put together, is to show how the LID approach both creates value and costs less. Because almost without exception, it really can achieve both those objectives by utilizing stormwater infrastructure to provide aesthetic functions to help increase the quality of place within a project, and also increasingly the market is getting this stuff. If a market is looking for a downtown cottage court, for example, so that they can walk to get a cup of coffee or a gallon of milk, green infrastructure, beautiful green infrastructure resonates with that market. So, and it costs less in comparison to typical, more highly engineered stormwater infrastructure. So really, to get outside of preaching to the choir, we believe it's the right thing to do environmentally. We also believe it can show and demonstrate, and that was part of the work we did for the EPA, that it does cost less and provide more value.
Great, thank you. This next one is for John, too. I have not seen any heavy vehicles on these roads. Can old-fashioned brick roads be used instead of asphalt? These are low speed bike-friendly roads. The cobblestone ride would also calm traffic besides improve stormwater quality.
I think it depends on context. What I typically do is, brick is one solution. I'll typically have for truck routes or for highly trafficked, highly traveled ways, probably not do permeable surfaces on those routes. I'll typically, especially in guidelines, to provide flexibility for kind of skittish applicants, designers, and town engineers to start with parking spaces, on-street parallel parking spaces, overflow parking. We have the requirement for, in these designing requirements for over slots over 10 spaces to require those spaces to be permeable. And I think brick or cobble travel ways can be a solution if they're properly designed with the right sub-base conditions and given the traffic loads. So again, not a specific answer, and it certainly is possible, but what I push for as a design engineer might be a little bit different from if I were working in establishing design guidelines and stormwater ordinance requirements for a municipality.
Okay. Could either of you discuss methods of maintaining the long-term performance of permeable pavements?
I'm sorry, Christine, could you say the last part of that question again?
Oh, sure, I'm sorry. Could either of you please discuss methods of maintaining the long-term performance of permeable pavements?
I could address that a little bit. Perhaps John, I'm sure, has something to add as well. One of the projects that we were fortunate enough to get almost immediately was a small market that repaved half of its driveway in response to our permeable paving request, and they did so willingly just before a huge storm last October. What they found was that it performed not only extremely well, because half the parking lot that was done with permeable paving did really well during the storm, the other half did not. When we talked to them about maintenance, and I've talked to a number of people around the country about this as well, all the parking lots are going to require some sort of maintenance anyway. And so whether it's sweeping, as has been done in the past, or whether it's vacuuming, as probably it should be done with permeable paving, there's still a maintenance cost to it. There's no doubt about that. But it needs to be maintained no matter what. And as long as they're maintained properly, they should perform well for the long term. One other example I can give you is that we had a large market that was recently approved. And we had the conventional paving actually in the area of the driveway where large trucks would be going, and permeable paving is proposed for the area where normal passenger car vehicles are as well. We told them the same thing, that normal maintenance is to be expected, and probably vacuuming as opposed to sweeping would certainly be preferable. There's no question about that.
Hiram, following up on that, this is really a topic in and of itself and came up quite often as we were putting this LID work together. I think it's important to understand that maintenance requirements for stormwater infrastructure, just like paving infrastructure, are always converted. So any stormwater management BMP requires maintenance. So the expectation that you could put permeable pavement or a rain garden in and leave it for 10 years, for 20 years, because it's LID, it is not the case. It does require maintenance. But to understand how that maintenance is often easier for LID, for example, a rain garden fire retention, it's easily seen. It can be done by a landscaping crew as opposed to other different types of utility, and it's lovable. So permeable pavement is replacing some other type of stormwater infrastructure that might have been required, like a storm scepter infiltrator, interceptor, I should say, or an underground system, all requires maintenance. So we wanted to put into the design guidelines and the ordinance some level of comfort with that. So we included a lot of information about how to maintain permeable pavement, how it performs differently in the winter. The design criteria requires that if you put permeable pavement in, you got to put a sign as well, because we get this stuff installed, and once the designer and the builder leave, the typical, say, a condo development or some other type of owner and operator might just either unknowingly or willingly ignore the differences for that type of BMP. But it is a BMP. It does require maintenance. We also included operation and maintenance plan to be required against the deed for new development, so that is on the book, as well as the discussion of an annual maintenance filing with the town to show that these are getting maintained. I should add very quickly that some of the research institutions, you can look up some of the work that UNH Stormwater Center has done, where they're trying to get permeable pavement to fail. They'll leave it for 5 years plus and then see how it performs. And it still works, even if it's banded, which it shouldn't be. It still works, it still infiltrates, and it's recoverable. It can be vacuumed. So I think to summarize, the more this gets built, the easier it will be, and the more you'll be able to point to projects within your community where it was done, and folks can see that it works, such as the one that Ira mentioned. And I think that will help more than anything.
Great, thank you. Well, it is 2:30, so we must close shop. We do have a bank of questions that we were unable to answer, so folks, please do extend those questions to our speakers. I'm just going to change the presentation back over to me for a quick moment just to do some housekeeping things. Perfect. Just some reminders that for those that are still in attendance, don't forget again to log your CM credits for attending today's webcast, and it is available for 1.5 credits. Also, I had a lot of questions. We are recording today's webcast, and you can see it live by going to YouTube and searching Planning Webcast, or you can simply email me if you just want a PDF of it, and you can email me at the email address shown on the screen, which is planningwebcast@yahoo.com. So thank you to our two presenters today, John and Hiram, and thank you to the Connecticut Chapter for hosting this, and to all of our participating divisions and chapters for making this webcast series available free. And everyone have a great afternoon. Happy weekend. Bye-bye, everybody.
Great. Thank you, Christine. Bye-bye.